we believe in made in India business model as opposed to copy-pasting global business model.
True.
India is a land of SMEs. You know, unlike consumer, SMEs are extremely heterogeneous.
True.
Which basically leads to heterogeneous unmet demands.
Hello and welcome to a brand new segment of FinTech Ki Baat Dil Se, VC Unfiltered. In this segment, we bring some of the best VCs across the globe to you and talk to them about various questions that the founders have shared with us that they want to ask these VCs. Stay tuned for more exciting content. On today's episode, we have with us Mr. Mayank Jain from Stellaris Venture Partners. Hey Mayank, great to have you here.
Hi Shares, great to be here.
Great, great. So Mayank, a day of holiday, right? On the day of Ganesh Chaturthi, thank you so much for taking out time and, you know, giving us like your precious 1 hour in the morning. Having said that, let's quickly start by talking a bit about your background. I've stalked you a little bit on LinkedIn and have understood that, you know, you have been an operator. You've also been a founder. You have been an entrepreneur in residence. So a very interesting background before you kind of got into the VC industry as such. So let's take us through it. What was your journey like and what essentially made you decide that, yeah, now I want to get into the VC industry?
So Shels, if you'd like, I can talk about my slightly like elongated background.
Sure, love to you.
So I'd been born and brought up in Delhi in a very Dhanda kind of a family. The most any in my family was educated was they had done their college for namesake. And I think the thinking was that, degrees for the society, so just get done with it and then come and join the family business.
Understood.
So grown up in that background, if I were to be candid, the importance of education, I'd say, was not the highest. So grown up in that setting, used to be a very average child growing up academically. Often in the bottom 50%. And then during 11th, my mother, inspired by one of our walking friends, so she had heard about this IIT JEE coaching center in Delhi called Vidya Mandir Classes, who at that time used to only admit no more than 160 students. And 3 out of 4 students used to get into IIT.
Wow.
And there are elaborate tuition classes which prepare you for the Vidya Mandir entrance exam. So it used to be a status symbol in the Delhi schools if you were admitted to Vidya Mandir. And that exam used to be a mathematics exam.
Right.
And that was the only subject that I was probably in the top 50% at school.
Okay.
And forcefully, I like, chalo, theek hai, let me, you know, give this exam. So gave that exam and basically got through with them under class.
Right.
And that's how my life changed and I got admitted to IIT Delhi. I am reasonably sure if not for Vidya Mandir classes, I would not be in IIT or any good college for that matter.
Well,
and Vidya Mandir, I think I found a strong coaching student fit. They used to say, Zyada mat padho, hum aapko thoda sa material de rahe hain, sirf yahi padho.
Achha.
And you'll be fine. And that is exactly what I needed. Anyways, I didn't have the capacity to study a lot. So got through IIT Delhi, mechanical engineering. Again, the 4 years at IIT Delhi, it was, I think, good hostel life, I think good fun. The standard college life that you could imagine. So all of that very nice 4 years happened, and then came the placement and the graduation season. I used to be probably at the median of the class at best, very much continuing with how the story used to be at school. So, you know, at that point in time, you know, I had this notion that an MBA would, you know, help me do well at business. And, you know, from my roots, it was very clear ke apna hi kuch dhanda karna.
Bilkul.
And then I asked around, they said that the best MBA college in India is IIM Ahmedabad. So, you know, studied for CAT. The only studying that I did in the 4 years of college, bailed the CAT and got admitted to IIM Ahmedabad straight from IIT Delhi.
Wow.
Again, you know, as I entered IIM Ahmedabad, I felt a little lost. Because unlike in IIT Delhi, I think people were very focused towards academics. And I was anything but academics.
Gotcha.
So I felt a little bit of misfit ki main kahan aa gaya hoon. So anyways, 2 years passed. Made some good friends. A three-month exchange in Europe was the highlight of my 2 years at Ahmedabad, which was a good trip. Anyways, I think after IIM Ahmedabad, where I found my footing was working at a small startup in Delhi. This was an e-commerce group called the Smile Group, and I joined them, I think, around late 2011.
Okay.
I distinctly remember that, you know, the startup ecosystem was extremely young at that time. And the reason I say that is, you know, I remember distinctly at that time, I going to my LinkedIn and finding friends who work at startups who could potentially refer me. And I couldn't find more than three across my batch at IIT Delhi and IIM Ahmedabad. You know, and story, of course, is very different today. Anyways, you know, spent an year with that, with Smile Group. I had a lot of fun. It was the first time where I, you know, worked very hard and I was enjoying it, which was very new to me. Because before that, I did have self-questions that can I even work hard?
Right.
After that, I said that now I feel ready to start my company. So in January of 2013, I started my HR tech company called Talent Pack.
Okay.
Along with two friends. I ran that for over 3 years till about early 2016. That 3+ years journey was fantastic. I had a lot of fun, learned a lot. You know, we scaled the business to $1 million plus in revenue, close to profitability, had raised a seed round from a venture fund at that time called Helion Ventures. And in fact, the individual from there who led the round then eventually went on to found Stellaris Venture Partners, and life came a full circle for me. But more on that later. For certain reasons, I mean, the startup couldn't scale beyond the $1 million plus in revenues. And I think without too much details, we basically pivoted to a transportation company, which didn't work out.
Okay. Interesting.
So then, you know, around mid of 2016, you know, moved from Delhi to Bangalore and took up a role at Fracto. Spent 2 years there, got my first exposure to, if I may say so, complex world of healthcare in India. You know, I used to head two business lines for them. And healthcare is complex. That is the first time I realized a majority of money that the doctor makes is actually not from the patients or consultation. It is, you know, from referral bonuses from a variety of providers like pharmacies, labs, hospitals, specialist doctors and whatnot. And there is an economic issue in that market. So spent 2 years there, you know, saw the journey at Practo. I think a very interesting journey when I joined. There were 2,000 employees. They had, you know, a little less than 20,000 paid clinics using their software. So, you know, saw scale at Practo. Then after that, ended up being a part of two very interesting fintech companies.
Right.
At that time, I felt that, fintech, I think, poses a lot of opportunity. That is also when the, Aadhaar came out, which is
right.
In, if I remember correctly, around the second half of 2016.
Mm-hmm.
UPI went live in the second half of 2017. True. So that is the time when I moved from Practo to Ola Financial Services. There I used to head credit cards and insurance business lines. I had a great experience. Learned a lot about credit cards and insurance. And after that, joined another fintech called Cred. Used to head strategy, corp dev, and investor relations there. And again, a very special company. And I can get into why I feel, Cred is special. And then I think...
Yes, it's slightly later. Huh? Yeah.
And, I think sometime during the journey, I realized that, I enjoyed the excitement of, pre-product market fit.
Mm.
And maybe just after product market fit to just before the aggressive scale-up journey.
Mm.
Or like some people call 0 to 1,
right.
1 to 10. But I felt that I did not enjoy the 10 to 100 part of the journey.
Mm.
It was a lot about the discipline of repetition.
Sure.
Whether it is weekly, functional reviews, business reviews, one-on-ones. And I felt that I was constrained in a box.
Mm.
I needed that width and variety, which I was not getting. And then I think there was that existential question that, look, what do I do next?
Sure.
Because I can't be the guy who goes through the 0 to 1, 1 to 10, but, is not the right person for the scaled up part of the journey.
Okay.
And that is the time when I went through a dating process with Stellaris Venture Partners. And because there was a long association and relationship,
mm-hmm.
Basically, I wanted to see, what VC is. What does a day-to-day of a VC look like? And, went through a little over 6 months dating process. Me getting to know VC and then said that, look, whatever I know in these 6 months, I think it's worth getting married.
Mm-hmm.
And it's been a little over 2 years of marriage.
Wow. I think that is really an interesting journey, right? Right from working for multiple startups, heading strategy, and building your own companies as well. I think you've almost gone through all the processes of the company, all the stages of a company, right? From 0 to 1, 1 to 10, and then also in Cred, if I'm not wrong, you are also there doing the scale-up process.
Yeah.
Awesome. So would love to hear a bit about why was that comment about Cred, right? Being a special company. I mean, it is indeed, as of now also in India, being called as one of the, I would say, the father of the fintechs, or probably, one of the fintechs that kind of started a lot of revolution across that segment. So, yeah, I mean, how was it there?
It was great. And I think a couple of reasons, where I feel Cred really shines. I think the first is just talent density. Very, very smart people, work at Cred. The second is a made in India business model.
Mm-hmm.
And if I were to speak more broadly, very strong first principle thinking.
Understood.
So actually, unlike the philosophy of fail fast, Cred
mm-hmm.
believed in the mantra of, do your homework well and make it succeed.
Right.
And often that needed a lot of first principle thinking, a lot of research, a lot of homework.
Mm-hmm.
And to the best of my knowledge, I don't know of a cred-like business model existing anywhere in the world.
Wow, interesting.
And that kind of says it all.
Great, great. I think that really gives us some insight into that. Having said that, you know, kind of let's go to the next stage of conversation. Let's talk a bit about Stellaris Venture Partners and what exactly, you know, is the investment thesis and how do you essentially invest in fintechs or startups as an overall this
side. So Stellaris Venture Partners is a homegrown VC fund.
Mm-hmm.
We came into existence in year 2017.
Mm-hmm.
So in many ways, we are also, you know, hustling to make a mark in the VC world.
Right.
2017 to 2020, we invested out of our first fund, made 19 investments. Some prominent companies include Palmer, Botfix, Propel, Noteshare, Signzy, and several others where we were often the first institutional lead investor.
Mm-hmm.
2021 onwards, we have been investing out of our second fund. This is a $225 million fund. We have made 20 investments in the last 2.5 years.
Mm-hmm.
We invest across sectors, but we do invest in tech or tech-enabled businesses.
Understood.
We basically come in at the seed and series A stages.
Mm-hmm.
And like to lead rounds.
Mm-hmm.
We can lead up to $5 million seed round and up to $10 million A round. So that is our playground.
Understood.
I'd like to believe that, you know, we are high conviction investors.
Mm-hmm.
We like to, you know, build conviction and then lead the round. I'd also like to believe that, you know, we believe in made in India business model as opposed to copy pasting global business model.
True.
And I think some of that has played out, that you can't just, you know, copy-paste global business model. India is a very special country with its own nuances, and you have to factor that in. So really a big believer of made in India business model.
Mm-hmm.
So absolutely, I think while we invest across sectors, fintech, of course, is one of the prominent sectors for us. I, along with my colleagues, we lead that. We need a fintech investment for the fund.
Great, great. So having said that, right, let's talk a bit about how you look at fintechs, right? I mean, you have been, if I'm not wrong, Stellaris has been around since 2017. That's almost 2 years after the fintech revolution began, almost 1.5 to 2 years after the fintech revolution began. So you have seen majority of the life cycle of fintechs, right, from the early B2C heavy models to, you know, later on B2B focused models, you know, driving the revolution around the banking, embedded finance and all of that, to the newer models that are emerging as we speak around the latest technology. So how has one would be essentially you as Mayank, how has your view been of this fintechs? What have you been excited through the history of fintech? And what are you excited about now? And as Stellaris, what essentially the same question, right? What have you been excited about throughout the evolution of fintechs previously? And now, what is it something that you want to see built or which is not yet built or which is not yet being built? So, yeah, over to you.
Yeah, so Shaz, I think one of the themes that we really like is basically SME lending. India is a land of SMEs. You know, unlike consumer, SMEs are extremely heterogeneous.
True.
Which basically leads to heterogeneous unmet demands.
True.
And I think it is no secret that there is a very large SME unsecured financing gap that exists.
Mm-hmm.
We all know of very large informal financing markets that have existed historically and continue to be very large.
Right.
So we do feel that's an opportunity.
Mm-hmm.
So while I think the problem is very well known, even the magnitude of the problem is very well realized.
Right.
I think that the trick lies in finding a viable solution to address that gap.
Understood.
You know, there is a reason, you know, MSME unsecured financing has been underserved, that historically it's been very hard to serve that segment while being profitable or viable.
True.
So there are, you know, three solution or business models that we like to serve SME financing. The first is what we internally call as anchor-lent financing, which is, you know, insert a credible anchor between yourself as financier and the end borrower.
Right.
And what that anchor does is twofold. It reduces the OPEX of the business by contributing to areas like distributing loans, you know, aiding in collections, which fundamentally reduce the OPEX of the business.
Right.
Because historically, one of the challenges has been that, you know, with these MSMEs, the ticket sizes are low.
Right.
And given the high OPEX, it becomes unviable to profitably serve a small SME.
Right.
So Anchor can, you know, help you in that direction. And in that team, we have invested in an education financing company called Propelled.
Yes.
Who have a very innovative model of leveraging educational institutes online and offline as anchors. And then distributing financing to their students.
Oh, interesting.
And they have an economic incentive to distribute because financing leads to more sales.
True.
The second solution we like is what we call as embedded lending, which is lending need not be your first offering to the customer.
Right.
And then let me take an example of CredFlow, which we have invested under this theme, which targets small manufacturers and distributors. They start off by providing a software which sits on top of the accounting software or Tally, sucks in all the data and provides analytics to the business owner on mobile at his fingertip.
Right.
So they are replacing the call that an owner would make to the accountant, ke ye data lekar aao, iska print out lekar aao, so on and so forth.
Got it.
And so software is their first offering, and then, you know, they contextually embed lending in the work.
Understood.
So that is an example of embedded lending. What embedded lending does is, again, it reduces the OPEX because, you know, software acquires the customer, you know, relatively economically efficiently. And then you have the attention of the borrower, you have the, you know, data to underwrite, and then you contextually embed lending.
Right.
The third solution that we like is what we call as nascent vertical lending. And Turno has been an investment in that theme. Turno, you know, was targeting a nascent vertical like intra-city commercial EVs. Now, that asset class is fundamentally so new. So that is an example under that theme. So these are the three solutions that we like broadly in SME lending. There are, of course, you know, some SME verticals that we are very excited by. Without going into too much detail, I'll just name them. One is SME construction contractors. Second is SME goods exporters. A third is indeed SME money lenders, informal money lenders. So these three, I think, are very interesting verticals. The second, in addition to SME lending, the second theme that we like is FinInfra. And again, there we do have very specific investment thesis. One is co-lending network.
Right.
Today, you know, for any two REs or regulated entities, let's say two, you know, a bank and an NBFC.
Right.
Real-time co-lending is non-trivial.
True.
So can can you become the de facto two-sided network, which acquires both sides for co-lending as well as builds the underlying infra for co-lending?
Understood.
The second specific thesis is what we call as offline post-lending, which is becoming a linchpin between four stakeholders. Imagine a Chroma, which is the merchant, which is one side. Second is the end consumer who's buying from a Chroma, which is the second side. The third is, you know, lenders and banks who want to provide financing to, you know, this customer at Chroma for POS. And the fourth is brands like Apple, LG, Panasonic and whatnot, who are also, you know, willing to provide economic incentives if it can lead to more sales for them. So becoming a linchpin amongst these four stakeholders is another, thesis.
Understood. Interesting. So I think from what I gather, as a VC, you are mainly excited about the MSME industry and how fintech is essentially revolutionizing that. That is probably one of the major pieces that kind of, you know, excites you from that perspective.
Yeah, there are more, but I thought maybe these are the two I like to go in some detail.
Understood. Having said that, right, when you currently look at, let's say, the next 5 years of evolution in fintech, what parts or what domains do you think would excite you or would you want to invest in it if it ever comes up? It may also be something that is not currently present in the market, but it's kind of on a wish list that if this comes up, this is something that I would love to invest in.
Yeah. So, Shias, in addition to, I think, what I've already spoken, I do feel, I think, the biggest opportunity lies in a credit. Because I think both consumers as well as SMEs are extremely credit starved.
Right.
So there will be a lot of innovation on credit form factors. In fact, I think very recent announcement by the regulator at the Global FinTech Festival held 10 days back on credit lines on UPI is extremely interesting.
True.
And of course, I wrote a thread on it as well, which we should share with our viewers. But that potentially, in my mind, will open a host of new opportunities for aspiring fintech founders.
Understood. Awesome. Thank you so much. I think that really gives us a perspective on how essentially you see the entire fintech segment moving forward and what would essentially be probably a few exciting areas in it. Having said that, let's go on to the final part of the episode or the final segment wherein we essentially, you know, take the questions that we get from the founders and we kind of, you know, put them out to you and have your view on it. Having said that, you know, one of the first questions that, you know, a lot of founders kind of came out to us with, specifically, you know, for investors who kind of invest in early stage startup, is that how would you advise or what would your advice be to early stage founders who come to pitch to you? What is one thing that they're doing wrong that you want them to?
So, Shias, if I had to pick one thing, I'd basically say do your homework well. And what that means is, you know, have the clarity on the thesis or the fundamentals of what you're trying to build. Specifically, five things in this order, for me at least. Having a view on TG or the customer segment that you plan to focus on and why. So let's call this TG. The second is, you know, the customer segment that you've identified could have a myriad of problems. But which is that one problem to begin with that you plan to focus your energies on and why this choice?
Right.
So that's the third is, okay, you have identified the problem, but what is your solution to solve that problem? And what is the insight behind the solution?
Right.
And why is your solution better than other solutions in the market for the same thing?
Understood.
The fourth is, okay, there is a problem, there is a solution. But is it economical? Is the solution economical viable? So having hypothesis or views on the economics or unit economics of the business. And fifth is go-to-market, which is, you know, how do you go-to-market? How do you acquire your customers?
True.
So let me just as a quick summary, TG, problem, solution, unit economics, go-to-market.
Perfect.
I do look for, you know, sharp set of hypotheses on each of these.
Understood. This question is actually slightly linked to the previous one as well, but a lot of founders also come and ask me ki, what do VCs essentially look for when they're evaluating a startup that is not kind of set up shop or is either in the idea stage or is just about to start. What do you look for? How do you evaluate it? And how do you arrive at a valuation?
To shares, I do want to first qualify that of the 20 investments as a fund we have made in the last 2.5 years, I think around 15 are seed investments, and within 15 also 11 or 12 would be idea stage seed.
Oh,
where there is no product, no revenue, no nothing, right? So look, again, I think at that stage, given that there is no execution to, you know, judge on,
right,
it is the set of hypotheses that the founder has, or what we like to, you know, call thesis.
True.
But thesis is nothing, a set of hypotheses on the five questions that I spoke about. And
right.
So we do look for a strong hypothesis.
Understood. And as a person, what do you look for in a founder, like in your first meeting or first two meetings?
See, first is, you know, a thesis. It's non-trivial, or it's very hard to arrive at a sound thesis.
True.
So if a founding team can arrive at a sound thesis, you know, that says a lot about the team itself. So that's an indirect way to also judge the team. So that is one. The second is founder market fit, which is every business, you know, has a beat or has different, you know, some business, you know, are very operationally heavy. Some business are very, you know, tech heavy. So we do look for whatever is the key to building that business. Does at least the important skill sets reside with the founders or not?
Right.
So if tech is a very critical part of the business and there is no tech co-founder, or let's say if a team is building a healthcare business and clinical expertise is a very critical part of the business and that doesn't reside with the co-founding team, then those are the things that we look for. So two things, thesis and founder market.
Understood. A question of my own that's kind of derived out of your two previous answers, right? Founder or the founding team versus the thesis, which would you give more weight?
So clearly, if I'm struggling, there is no clear answer. I think it's very, very contextual. But from the way I operate, at least my thumb rule is, or gating criteria is, that if there is no sound thesis, it's a no for me.
Understood.
With two exceptions, which is, you know, one exception is that, you know, where the founder does not have a thesis, but we have a thesis, and we think highly of the founder, you know, to reach that thesis.
Understood.
The second exception is founder is just so exceptional. It doesn't care if there is thesis, no thesis. You know, you just take my money.
The founder is...
But again, those are exceptions. The norm is you need to have a sound thesis. If you don't have a sound thesis, you know, you're a no. If there is a sound thesis, then there is another gating criteria that, you know, is this a subjective view on founder market fit? And again, if that is not there, again, it's a no.
Right.
Now, some of these things are subjective, but at least it is sequential for me. You know, thesis and then founder.
Got it. Perfect. Let's move on to the next question. I think this is a really interesting one. Do Indian VCs fall for FOMO while investing in startups? If yes, what's the best way to create FOMO?
So look, I think we are all humans.
Mm-hmm.
We all have FOMO for different set of things.
Sure.
So absolutely, I think, you know, there is FOMO. You know, there are different extent in different individuals. The way to create FOMO is basically basically, you know, have competition.
Mm-hmm.
So if you can, if you can get that term sheet for another VC or make material progress, you know, amongst other VCs, then it puts pressure for you to act at least once.
Right.
So I would like to believe that, you know, FOMO doesn't lead to, you know, my decision changing, but FOMO will make me reach a decision first. Do my homework and reach a decision first.
Understood. No, I think this is interesting. We have one more really polarizing question as such. Let's kind of put it at that. I won't spoil it for you before asking you the question. The founder asks, and I paraphrase, why do VCs ask that dumb question that if Google or Amazon starts a similar business, to aapka kya hoga? Even ChatGPT is replaceable with Bart, Tesla is replaceable by BMW electric cars. There is no market barrier for literally anything in this world, even in patented deep tech.
So very simple answer.
Mm-hmm.
Asking these questions often are an indirect way to assess the team.
Understood.
So goal of asking the question is to understand how deeply the team has thought about this question. Who do they consider as competition?
Mm-hmm.
You know, have they thought about the second order details that if they do something, how will each of the competition react? And then how will they react? So often it is an indirect way of judging the team.
So from what I understand, this is a way to understand ki founding team ne kitna homework kiya hai and how in depth they have gone, right? So makes sense. Perfect. One, I think we'll pick the last question for the day. Let me just check if there is any. Yes, I think this should be very interesting. What exactly are the key metrics as a VC you would want to hear in a founder's pitch?
Key metrics. So Shreyas, again, I think it's very hard to generalize as every business is, you know, different. I'll tell you a framework. I try to assess which is the greatest risk in this business. And then I look for metrics around that risk. But to be specific, often I have seen product market fit risk to be the biggest one. So to assess product market fit, typically I look at metrics like customer retention, both unit retention and dollar retention. That is one. The second metric I look at often before retention is usage or adoption. That is a leading indicator to retention.
Right.
The third metric I look at is organic new customer growth. If there are word of mouth effects, then that will, you know, reflect in organic new customer growth month on month.
Of course.
So those three.
Makes sense. I think that was the final question of the day, and Mayank, you've really given some fresh perspective on a few of those things and misconceptions that I think a lot of founders had. Especially the one that kind of stood out to me was the one where the founder had asked, ki, why do you ask the questions? Ki, agar koi badi company kar legi, toh, how will you, you know, look at it? So I think that really made a lot of sense when you said that it's how you evaluate the team to understand ki kitna in-depth homework kiya hai and all of that. So yeah, thanks a lot, Mayank. I think this is our time for the day. Thank you so much. It was such a pleasure having you here and learning from you. Thank you so much.
Sure. Thank you so much for having me, and I hope the audience took away something.